First he was a saint. Afterwards he was an alcoholic, a drunkard, a woman chaser, a very handsome man, charming man, and I don't think so I could resist him if he would make advances to me, but he saved us. In first place, he was our saver.
Bio je osebujan bon vivan, trgovac na crnom tržištu i kockar, pijanac i ženskar. Za Njemce je bio odani agent vojnih obavještajaca. Bio je i Oskar Schindler, čovjek koji je Hitleru otimao Židove. U Hitlerovoj vrijeme poslovao i prosperirao. Postao je uistinu bogat čovjek. U Čekoslovačkoj Poljskoj Hitlerovoj vojsci služio kao špijun. Njegove su tvornice oružja potpomagale nacističko ratovanje. No Oskar Schindler sagradio je i vlastiti koncentracijski logor, te je uz veliki osobni rizik postao jedini Njemac u povijesti rata koji je od plinskih komora logora smrti spasio više od 1000 Židova. Ovo je istinita priča o enigmi koja se zove Oskar Schindler. Prvog rujna 1939. Adolf Hitler govori o oduševljenom Reichstagu da će Njemačka napasti Poljsku. Noć prije, u nizu lažiranih provokativnih incidenata, Njemačku su pograničnu radiopostaju navodno pregazili poljski vojnici. U stvarnosti su ti napadači bili njemački vojnici odjeveni u odore poljske vojske, koje je priskrbio agent njemačkih vojnih obavještajaca Oskar Schindler. Tjedan dana poslije, Njemci triumfalno stupaju poljskim gradom Krakovom, te ga proglašavaju glavnim gradom svojega osvojenoga teritorija na istoku. Krakov ima jedno od najrazvijenijih židovskih zajednica u Europi, te zbog toga vrlo brzo osjeti utjecaj novih vladara. Zatvaraju se sinagoge u kojima ljudi slave svoju vjeru od 14. stoljeća. Iznimka je samo snimanje propagandnih filmova. Na snagu stupa niz zakona koji utječu na cjelokupno stanovništvo, no odredbe su posebno stroge za Židove. Kontrolirat će svaki aspekt života. Židove izbacuju iz njihovih domova. Okupljaju ih i grupiraju kao stoku, bez ikakvih prava. Nasumična, trenutačna odmazda.
I remember being very, very unhappy the first few weeks. It came about the Jewish holidays and I remember like today standing with my mother in a little synagogue and crying and they were all strange people around us. And but little by little they reduce us to nothing. So
how did they do that, Rivka?
Very systematically, they were coming with all sorts of gimmicks. They first of all had what we would call an action. Ever so often, they reduced the amount of people living in ghetto simply by selecting this one will stay and this one will go.
My father and mother, the youngest sister and the youngest brother. The Germans put them on an area in the middle of the town and they asked the men to go to one side and the women and children on the other side. People knew that the men will go to a camp to work. And my father had decided that he will not leave my mother, my brother and a sister. He went over on the other side, and my mother was holding a child in her hand, and my father was holding a child in her hand, and they shot him on the spot. I know it for a fact, because a few days later, people who knew my father and mother came to the camp, and they told me the story. They were crying. They felt that they had neglected, and they felt that my father was like the less defines, like a hero. And that's the insanity of it, that we, the innocent, felt guilty what the murderers did to us.
Njemački je velebni plan bio da će jednoga dana Krakov, Poljska i Europa biti potpuno oslobođeni od Židova. Do tada mogu iskorištavati židovski i robovski rad. Židove bez radne dozvole deportiraju. Rad bar nudi priliku da prežive.
Walking on one of the streets, I was suddenly stopped by a few SS people that jumped out of a truck and rounded up people. And before we know, we were on the road on to some place. We didn't know exactly where we were going, but we did wind up in what was later on known to us as the Marienwerke. And at that time, Schindler appeared where the SS guards lined us up for his inspection. He looked at us and he selected me out of the group, picked me out, and he declared to the SS guards that he doesn't want any children. He said in German, "Ich brauche keine Kinder here." The SS guards replied very quickly that when we bring you people, you keep them. And that they parted with him, and he kept the all of us that they delivered.
Die Deutsche Emalwarenfabrik Oskara Schindlera, ili Emalija, kako su je zvali židovski radnici. Schindler je ovu propalu tvornicu za proizvodnju emajliranog posuđa kupio u prosincu 1939. Isprva kao paravan za svoje obavještajne aktivnosti. 31-godišnjeg Schindlera ništa u njegovoj prošlosti nije pripremilo ni na kakvu ulogu heroja. Rođen je u malom industrijskom gradiću Cvitau na području Sudeta u Čehoslovačkoj. Odgojen je u strogom katoličkom duhu, iako je išao u razred s nekoliko židovskih učenika, a prvi moj susjed bio rabin koji je imao dva sina. Mladi Oskar bio srdačan dječak slabog uspjeha u školi, koji je čak i tada uživao biti u središtu pozornosti. Kao tinejdžer je zavolio brze automobile i motocikle, u čemu mu je njegov otac udovoljavao. A onda se 1928. oženio s Emilije, religioznom djevojkom iz susjednog sela. 30. je godina bio sitni trgovac, a zatim je postao nacistički špijun. Česi su ga uhitili u kolovozu 1938. na oslobođenje nakon što je Hitler anektirao Sudete. Postao je član nacionalsocijalističke stranke, te je ponovno mogao uživati u životu kao playboy i tajni agent.
Er war ein Mann, der das Leben geliebt hat, ein großer Lebemann. Das muss ich sagen. Die Frauen haben ihm alle gefallen. Gegen eine Frau können sie ankämpfen, aber nicht gegen 10 oder 100 Frauen. Also soll das schwimmen und rennen, ne? Stimmt das? Also mich hat das überhaupt nicht gestört. Sie können einen Menschen nicht ändern, wenn er so ist. Das ist bloß ein Unsinn, wenn sie wer mit einem Menschen streiten oder wer weiß ich was. Ich habe mit niemandem gestritten. Er liebte die Frauen, er liebte die Gesellschaft. Er liebte, was soll ich sagen, manchmal, dass die anderen die Arbeit getan haben. Das hat ihm sehr gut getan, wenn die anderen haben gearbeitet und er hat nichts gemacht.
He was very vain, as we can put it. He liked to put, for example, plenty of perfume on himself. When he went to Monopoly, this was in Krakow, part of government agency for the monopoly for liquor, for tobacco and everything. So when he went there, so everybody knew Mr. Schindler is here because the whole hall was, this was the smell of his perfume. Oscar liked to have attention from everybody. He liked to be the center of the attraction.
he was impulsive, but not in a way that something bad or something, but let's do it, let's go. So, example, we went to Berlin and we walked in the streets and there was a big store with cars. So we are looking through the window, there was a beautiful car, light blue, Horch. So he asked me, shall I buy the car? I said, so go ahead, buy the car. I was laughing. He was not kidding. He just went to the other people and so they gave him money and he bought the car.
Bilo je sigurno da će njemački poslovni čovjek s golemim sportskim automobilom privlačiti pozornost u okupiranoj Poljskoj. Naime, u toj zemlji manjkalo svega. No budući da je na crno tržište plasirao čak do 90% proizvoda svoje tvornice, Schindler je prikupio pravo malo bogatstvo, ali i sam je puno kupovao na crnom tržištu.
The things Schindler bought on the black market were diamonds, fur coats, beautiful Persian carpets, famous artist paintings, anything that has a tremendous value at present or even in future, because only this way he could bribe those people what he needed for his particular purpose.
No Schindlerova posebna svrha bila je sve samo nejasna. Njegovi su Židovi svakoga dana putovali iz geta u tvornicu. Svakoga su im dana prijetile deportacije ili još i gore. Nakon što su neki od njegovih radnika uhićenih, oslobodio ih je tako da je podmitio SS. Koristeći se informacijama koje je dobivao od najviših časnika, uspijevao je upozoriti svoje radnike na racije. A onda su potkraj 1942. Njemci odlučili zatvoriti geto. Ovdje, na ovim poljima, u predgrađu Krakova, na mjestu gdje se u Jeruzalemskoj ulici nalazilo židovsko groblje, ovdje su trebali sagraditi logor za prisilni rad za Židove, koji su još morali raditi za Njemce. Raznijeli su židovsku mrtvačnicu. Zatočeni Židovi bili su prisiljeni oskvrnuti grobove svojih predaka kako bi izgradili cestu do kampa. Ovdje će nastati logor za prisilni rad Plašov, dom za 20.000 židovskih muškaraca, žena i djeca. SS-ov časnik poručnik Amon Get tek je završio s likvidacijama geta u Lublinu, te je doveden u Krakov kako bi vodio novo izgrađeni logor i nadzirao uništavanje ostataka židovskog života u Krakovu.
Amon Get himself with his SS men was in charge. Elderly women, children, sick people were shot on the spot and they were brought up with flat trucks into our camp in Plaszów. I myself with a group of other boys had to unload the people who were shot. In one case, we asked a German, because a young kid was there and it wasn't dead yet. And we asked her, would you give a Gnadschuss, a Gnade. Gnade is the word like a kindness. So we will not bury you alive. And he said, throw it in, it's a schade. He said, it's a shame to waste a bullet on that schmutzig Jude. And we had to pour gasoline over them. And we kept on burning them.
Njemci ponosno snimaju svoje jurišne odrede na djelu. No, jedan je Njemac htio zaštititi svoje ljude od orgije ubijanja.
On the morning of March 13, 1943, Schindler has told us not to return to the ghetto as we would normally do, but to remain there and make the best of it by sleeping wherever we can, because there was trouble in the ghetto. The ghetto was being liquidated, there's killings going on, and he wants to keep us over that period. During that period, while I was in the factory, staying over for the next three nights and worked during days or worked nights, the ghetto was liquidated together with my family of parents, two sisters, two brothers. The one brother was shot down as he tried to cross from one line to another one. The rest of the family's fate is unknown to me, but I suspect they went to Auschwitz. I have never seen him since.
Tih je dana u getu ubijeno više od 2000 ljudi. Preživjeli su krenuli u novi život iza bodljikave žice.
It was frightening. It was very sad. I think the first time I realized that there is no way out. People were committing suicide right then and there. I remember a doctor's mother that took some poison in the same barrack where I was staying. This was the beginning. Then one day they came and they told us to give everything that we own in way of money and jewelry and things like that. And we had to put it on the pile and this was the end of it.
U vili smještenoj unutar logora, zapovjedniku Amunugetu, nisu nedostajali mali luksuzi koji su olakšavali život odanim slugama Trećeg Rajha. Ljeto 1943. bilo je veoma toplo. Get je u vilu ubrzo doselio svoju ljubavnicu, Njemicu Ruth. Pa kako se osjećala ta tada 24-godišnja djevojka koju vidimo kako sada umire od emfizema? Kako se osjećala okružena ostacima krakovskog židovstva, mladima i starima?
I never see any old people and I never saw any children. I just saw, I remember one afternoon there came a big car and this car was full of children they went somewhere and I had a girlfriend there, the wife of Mr. Scherner, and I said, oh, look at that, they are bringing the children somewhere, and I was down, you see, and it went to my heart somehow, and she had herself two children, oh, she said, they're Jews.
Kako bi udovoljio svojim glazbenim interesima, Get je iz redova logoraša doveo vlastite glazbenike, braću Hermana i Lea Roznera.
I got full dress, I got tuxedo, I got street suit. So whenever I played by the commandant, I used one of those three, never prisoner's garb. And it depends what kind of party it was, it just called the police and they told me, Rosenberg, come down, that's it. Usually after killings, to clear his conscience, most of the time he called us. For not long, but parties he played very long.
Uskoro je na getove zabave često počeo svraćati poslovni čovjek Oskar Schindler. Svojim je neobaveznim šarmom mogao osvojiti bilo koga. Schindler, kojega je pratio glas da štiti židove, postoje bliski prijatelj Amona Geta, čovjeka koji je nadgledao pokolju getu, jednog od najstrašnijih Njemaca u Krakovu.
Amon Get took out 50 boys, I was one among them, and we went out to make a garden, and on the way home, one boy had escaped. And when we came in to the gates, and they start counting us, and they thought it was only 49. They wouldn't let us enter, and they call on Get. Get came down with a few SS, and he was screaming and yelling, where's the 50th? And we act that we don't know. We really didn't know. We couldn't say that we saw him escape. So he took every second one, 25 or 24, one to the right of my hand and one to the left. We're shooting them on the spot. And he said, that's what's happening if any one of you ever escape. And we make ourselves almost like a promise that we are responsible for our friends. How can we save one life and put in jeopardize 25 or even maybe more?
It wasn't a brutal killer. No, not no more than other people, other SS people was it. No more. He didn't, it's just for the fun of it, you see. He wasn't a brutal killer. He thought that what all the SS thought about Jews.
And what was that?
That they were there just to work. He didn't kill them just for the fun of it, you see. And it was not a camp where people in Vernichtungslager like Auschwitz.
But there were a lot of bodies that were dug up at Plaszów. Where did they come from?
I don't know. I don't know. He killed some Jews too, natürlich. And such a camp, it's not amusing. It's not amusing, really not. I stayed often in the kitchen with my maids and always said to them, if I could do anything, I would to all of you say, go home. But I can't do anything.
Jedna od tih sluškinja bila je mlada logorašica, židovka Helena Hirsch.
Przede wszystkim był sadystą. Ale w postaci pięknego człowieka, to bym nie uwierzyła nigdy w takim człowieku, taki szatan może się zachować. Morderca, żonny krwi. Pewnego razu Goetz, to było rano, wcześniej, rano miał wyjść, woła mnie do siebie. Oczywiście biegiem przyleciałam. Wskazuje mi na rękaw, była plama, możliwe otarcie z muru, możliwe, nie mam pojęcia z jakiego powodu, było rzeczywiście, ale nieznaczna plama. To ja mówię, słuchaj, ja nie wiem, Poldek to był jego płucy but, który przygotowywał ubranie, but Cholewy mu czyścił. Możliwe, że on nie zauważył. Oczywiście na to ja dostałam. Zostałam spoliczkowana w taki sposób, że momentalnie ogłuchłam i zaczęło mi dzwonić w uchu niesamowicie. To ja się odzywam do niego, Herr Kommandeur, jemand läutet an der Tür. Na to on mnie wszczelił po raz drugi w twarz, że mi prysła krew z ucha. Oczywiście on bez wrażenia to mi gej du as, du hure. Tu idzisz febrecherin.
You were living with a man who hated Jews.
He didn't hate them. It's too much.
Let me put it a different way. You yourself have said
that... Do you think Schindler liked Jews? He loved them or no? No. What I said, he was a lovable opportunist and he needed them, so he worked with them. But he didn't take them on his heart.
Dakle, za SS je bio šarmantni oportunist. No Schindleru je zbog čestih posjeta logoru omogućen i lak pristup zatvorenicima. Zatvorenicima poput Helene u njezinoj podrumskoj kuhinji.
I razu pewnego przyszedł na... Był w dobrym humorze, może lubiał pić, nie powie, że nie. I objął mnie tak. Pan rozumie, wtedy Niemiec obejmuje Żydówkę, to było Rassenschande. Ja się strasznie przelękłam. Ja się usuwam od niego. To on mówi, nie bój się. to objęcie moje i nawet ten cał, który ja złożę na twoim czole, to nie jest to, co ty myślisz. To jest ojcowski, przyjacielski sposobunek i chciałbym ci bardzo pomóc. I to tak stale przychodził. Razu pewnego wyszedł ze mną na podwórze i naprzeciwko pracowali ludzie. Zwozili kamienie. Te zwożenie tych kamieni to była taka syzyfowa praca. Skończyli zwozić, to jest powrotem wysyłali. I tak było. I on tak stoi ze mną, obejmuje mnie. Mam wrażenie, że wtedy getta nie było w kuchni, w ogóle we willi. Mam wrażenie. I powiada, ty znasz te przejścia Żydów, jak pracowali w Egipcie. Tutaj też pracują ci Żydzi. Ale ty też pamiętasz, że ich uratowano z Egiptu. Wyszli cało i zdrowi z Egiptu. Wy też zostaniecie wybawieni z tego piekła. To były jego słowa. Zawsze przychodził z pocieszeniem.
Did you get the sense that Schindler was a good Nazi?
We all were good Nazis in this sense. We couldn't be anything else. We had to believe in all these things. What could we have done? Nothing. Couldn't have do anything against it.
Početkom 1943. Oskar Schindler skovao je nevjerojatan plan. Na praznoj parceli u dvorištu svoje tvornice se gradit će vlastiti koncentracijski logor za 1000 židova. Ovdje će u ovim drvenim barakama živjeti njegovi radnici i radnici susjednih tvornica. Iskoristit će svoje prijateljstvo sa SS-om i zapovjednikom Amonom Getom, te skloniti židove od nasumičnog terora, plašova, u sigurnost svoje tvornice u ulici Lipova, u takozvanoj Emaliji.
Of course the conditions in Emalia were entirely different from Plaszów and for the first time we felt safe. We somehow knew that all the things that happened to us, like that 25 lashes and things of that sort can never happen there. And they didn't. They never did happen. Whenever the Germans came to Emalia, somehow Schindler was able to give the message to us, let's say somebody was cooking something, to remove everything from the stove. And even when Get came, the doors and the shutters were closed. And he, from the barracks where the people worked for Schindler were closed when the Germans came. And he explained to them, these are the barracks of my company. And no soldiers, no SS men ever walked into our barracks.
So people are eating, they have bread. It was like to fall on the other planet. Mr. Schindler came to the garage. They told me, the people, now Oskar Schindler is coming. So he greets me, even he give me his hand. I was afraid to give him a hand, to shake hands. But he told me, don't be afraid. I heard you were a good mechanic, so you will enjoy your staying here and don't be afraid, you will never be hungry. And so I told him Polish to my friends when he went out, tell me, he's a bluffer or it is so. So said, no, it is so, it is so.
Zahvaljujući crnom tržištu i jeftinom židovskom robovskom radu, sitni je predratni trgovac postao uspješan poslovni čovjek s privatnom ergelom konja. A uvečer je pio i zabavljao se sa svojim vezama iz vojske i SS-a. šarmom i dijamantima kupovao je sigurnost svojih židova.
Die Verständigung wurde mehr darauf zurückgeführt, dass man das bezahlen musste. Das wurde noch mit Brillanten, nicht mit Geld, nein, das waren immer kleine Geschenke von Brillanten und andere Sachen. Nicht? Aha, das musste gegeben werden. Geld hat keinen Wert. Das mussten Schmuckstücke, das mussten auserlesene Schmuckstücke sein, mit denen man das bezahlte, dass die Menschen dort bleiben. Aber diese Menschen musste mein Mann den SS bezahlen.
Ali sam Schindler nije bio iznad svake sumnje. SS ga je uhitio tri put, a u zatvoru je proveo ukupno tjedan dana. Optužbe su varirale od trivijalnosti do uključenosti u velike prijevare na crnome tržištu, zbog čega je mogao dobiti smrtnu kaznu. No svaki je put pušten zbog veza među vojnim obavještajcima i u inspektoratu za naoružanje.
Das war die Rückendeckung von der Abwehr. Und auf der anderen Seite war das deutsche Rüstungskommando. Und dort war das, er nämlich die Juden behalten konnte, damit die Juden nicht nach Auschwitz gefahren werden. Das hat die deutsche Rüstungskommando wieder bewerkstelligt. Nur die SS musste bezahlt werden, damit sie nicht zum Schluss aus Böshaftigkeit, aus Boshaftigkeit die Menschen wegnehmen und erschießen.
Ovdje vidimo tajnog agenta Schindlera na obavještajnom zadatku u Turskoj. Ona mu je otputovao u svojem sportskom automobilu marke Horch, te je nakon sastanka s njemačkim veleposlanikom von Papenom otišao u razgledavanje. Poslije je iste te godine postao dvostruki agent. Glavni grad Mađarske, Budimpešta, tada je bio još relativno pošteđen ratnih strahota, te ondje mogla djelovati židovska organizacija za pomoć. Schindler je doputovao iz Krakova, prokrijumčaren u novinskom kamionu, te se sastao sa židovskim agentom u Budimpešti i Samuelom Springmanom. U Grand Hotelu detaljno mu je opisao sudbinu krakovskog geta. Kao dokaz, donio mu je upute koje je dobio od zapovjednika geta o deportacijama židova. Zatim se vratio u Krakov s novcem za pomoć zatvorenicima u Plašovu. Njemci su potkraj 1943. bili prisiljeni na povlačenje na ruskome bojištu. Na zapadu su se saveznici iskrcali u Italiji. U Krakovu je Schindlerova tvornica slavila četvrtu obljetnicu rada. Sada nije proizvodio samo posuđe, nego i streljivo za rat. Budući da mu se rat približavao sa svih strana, njemački stroj za istrebljenje ubrzao rat u mahnitom nastojanju da provede takozvano konačno rješenje. Židove iz cijele Europe trpaju ravno u plinske komore i peći Auschwitza. A onda su sredinom 1944. Njemci bili prisiljeni razmontirati svoje logore blizu granice, jer su Rusi počeli sve snažnije nadirati kroz Poljsku. Ključne ratne industrije preselit će na sigurnije. Židovskih će se radnika jednostavno riješiti. Napokon će razoriti Schindlerovo utočište.
In August 1944, Schindler was ordered to reduce the size of the inmates of his camp of what was approximately 1000 people by 2/3 and leave 1/3 as his workforce. The SS guards helped in that shipment and separation of the 700 people to be shipped to Krakow-Plaszów. As the SS guards were marching in front of the people and making the selection with Schindler's help, I found myself what I thought in the wrong group where I would be shipped out rather than remain in the Emalia works. I at that time ran forward from my line towards Schindler, and I declared to him, "Herr Schindler, kein Tischler ist geblieben," which meant that there was no carpenter left in the factory. Oskar Schindler took me very seriously for my statement, and he took me by my arm and put me into the group of 300 people, and that's how I remained with the group of 300.
No, Schindler je izgubio 700 Židova. Nekoliko dana poslije utrpali su ih u stočne vlakove u Plašovu, kako bi ih prebacili u logor smrti Mauthausen. U vrelini tog ljetnog dana čekali su zatvoreni u vagonima, a Schindler je za vrijeme posjeta getu saznao kakva ih sudbina očekuje. Dobio je dozvolu da ih nahrani, te pred samim zapovjednikom naredio da vagone istuširaju vodom, kako bi se rashladili. Podmitio je stražara SS-a da na svakoj postaji otvore vrata. Preživjelih 300 židova i dalje je vjerovalo, iako su do rujna zatvorili Emiliju, a radnike prebacili u Plašov. Međutim, Schindlerovo je intenzivno mešetarenje urodilo plodom. Proizvodnja je bila proglašena ključnim elementom ratnog napora, pa će se tvornica sada premjestiti u sigurnost Brinlica, u blizini Schindlerova doma u Čekoslovačkoj. Dobio je dozvolu da sa sobom povede 1000 radnika specijaliziranih za metalurgiju.
At that time, they made a list of people that were supposed to stay and the one that were going. So the idea was to keep all the women and the family of women together. Unfortunately, some never made it. Men or women, for that matter. And the list was made in a very funny way. I think everybody had something to do with it, whether it was Schindler or Mr. Bankier or the Jewish policeman or even the German engineer, the work for Schindler. A little bit of personal vendetta went into it. And this is how it happened, that people that work from the beginning, they gave their best, never made to Brinlitz, and never survived.
Ovo je Schindlerova lista. Popis 1000 sretnika koji će preživjeti. No, budući da je Schindler izgubio 700 židova tijekom deportacije u kolovozu, sada su se otvorila mjesta za pridošlice iz Plašova. U borbi za mjesto na popisu procvala je korupcija. Za taj proces bio zadužen getov čovjek od povjerenja, zatvorenik Marcel Goldberg.
I asked him, Marcel, would you be so kind and put me on the list? So the first question what he asked me, do you have diamonds? Do you have dollars? I said, Marcel, I don't have no diamonds. I have no dollars, but we are very good friends for so many years, from before the war. So he said to me, I don't want to use the vulgar words, but he said, you will die here. You will not go no place. Without the diamonds, without this, were diamonds, but he has, were taking not for anybody else, only for himself. This was his personal business.
On this list, I saw my name, Pinchera Moses, my date of birth, and as Beruf, it's written down, a metal sheet worker. I give you my word. I never put it down. I was never a metal worker. As you heard from my experience that I went to camp being a Barackenbau builder, then later I worked in the kitchen. If I would be some kind of a fanatic, or it would be years back, I would say that an angel flew down, marked down my name.
Sluškinja Amona Geta, Helena Hirsch, potajno je Schindleru ponudila 400 zlota da je stavi na popis. Prihvatio je novac i osigurao joj slobodu na krajnje nekonvencionalan način.
Schindler zostao s Getem i začeli igrati u karti. Nie wiem, nie znam tej gry tam, ale dość na tym, że Schindler powiedział, kto wygra, ten dostaje, to było wtedy na tę listę mnie trzeba było wziąć, a on się jeszcze wszystko nie zgadzał. Nie chciał pozwolić, żeby mnie wziąć na listę. To on mówi, kto wygra, ten dostaje tę Lenę na listę. Oczywiście grali. I Schindler wygrał. 14 000 złotych. To była suma wtedy. Co on mówi do niego? No więc? Co Giet się odzywa? Ja jej nie dam. To mówi, słuchaj, graliśmy, bądź fair.
A onda je tu bio i Julius Madrić, još jedan vlasnik tvornice s prisilnim radnicima iz Plašova, koji je htio da i njegove zatvorenike prebace u Brinlitz. Schindler je pristao povesti 60 radnika.
When Madrić came one day, he says he can send some people to Brinlitz, to Schindler, and if we want to go with our families, He's going to take care of this, which he did. And I was one of the luckies, my wife and me, we wind up in Brindis.
What happened, as far as you know, to the majority of workers who worked for Madrić who didn't take this option to go to Brindis?
They went to different camps, let's say, some went to Dachau, some went to Mauthausen. Some survived, some no, like another camp.
Na kraju je na popis putnika za Brindis se natrpano 1100 muškaraca, žena i djece. Svi su navodno bili prijeko potrebni za proizvodnju streljiva. 15. listopada 1944. 800 muškaraca napustilo je Plašov u stočnim vagonima. No umjesto u Schindlerovoj tvornici na jugozapadu, sljedeći su ih dan istovarili u koncentracijskom logoru Gross-Rosen.
Gross-Rosen was really a nightmare. When we arrived at first, they opened the doors of the cattle cars. When we came out, they had the kapos standing with gloves on their hands. They looked very elegant. And they herded us all to one assembly place, which they call Appelplatz. On that assembly place, the first thing they did, they asked us all to disrobe. And this was in October, was quite cold. We all disrobed, and the next thing, they ran us into a shower. We were very apprehensive as far as the shower went. We weren't sure whether we are going to get gas or water. When the water came out, it was a great relief. They kept us all, a few hundred people, in a place which accommodated maybe 30 or 40 people. So what we did, we slept on the floor with our spread eagle legs, and we fitted one into another. This was the only way that they could fit us all into the barrack. And this is how we slept the first night. And this is how we slept the next night. On the third day, I think, the angel arrived. Oskar Schindler came. And as soon as we had seen Schindler, it was like the gates of heaven opened up for us. At that moment, everybody felt safe. If Schindler is here, then nothing will happen to us. And sure enough, a couple of days later, we were transported to Brindis.
Priče o tome kako su i zašto muškarci pušteni variraju. Upitno je, je li Schindler bio prisutan? No, dva dana nakon što su muškarci stigli u sigurnost Brindlica i 300 žena iz Plašova krenulo je na put prema novom logoru. U 12 sati prešli su samo 60 kilometara do ulaznih vrata Auschwitza.
I remember arriving to Auschwitz at night and they opened the door from the train and they said everybody out. So everybody got out. And we marched in silence and right away I noticed the chimneys with fire coming out of them and I didn't say anything, I just motioned to my sister-in-law, to my husband's sister and showed her the chimneys. And they brought us closer and closer to the area where the chimneys were. To some barracks, I don't know exactly what it was, and they told us to get undressed completely, to put our belongings on one side, and to enter the room for a shower. And we stayed there, and we stayed there, and there was no shower, really. And because it took such a long time, the people that worked there, the Jewish people, were sure that the next morning they will really finish us off, they will put us to the gas chambers and burn us.
You know, the sky was all red around us. The smell was kind of different, you know, but we still didn't believe that those things were going on. You know, even when we were told by the Slovak women who were in Auschwitz from the very beginning, that means since 1940 or something, and they were telling us, you're not going to survive, when we asked if we could keep this of our possession or that, why are you worried about it? You're not going to live another day. And so we weren't sure what's going to happen afterwards. But still, we hoped that everything would be all right. You know, that's the optimist, the perennial optimism of the Jews, I suppose.
The next day when they put us outside, Dr. Mengele came over to review the parade, and I remember people referring to him as Angel of Death. And we went through the first selection in Auschwitz. He used to ask women that were younger than myself today, how old are you, grandma? Or children that were in the group, what's your age? And then, of course, they took the old people on one side, and the rest of us were pushed to the good side. And they took us to Birkenau, which was one part of Auschwitz, and we stayed there for 3 weeks. And through those 3 weeks, I think I must have been at least three times undressed naked for a selection. I was very skinny at that time, and I didn't know really which part of my body to push out more to look heavy and healthy.
From the very beginning, we realized in Auschwitz that everything was meant for death, not for life. There was no soap. There was no glass in the windows. The water, of course, was freezing cold. This was November in Auschwitz. And the mud was up to our mid-calves. We had no stockings, of course, no underwear of any kind, no sanitary conditions of any kind, absolutely no toilet paper, no nothing that a woman, let's say, needs for her sanitary condition. And we began to be very, very hungry because the diet was zero. But we couldn't even eat what we've got because we all developed dysentery.
Some people really couldn't take it. They were emotionally not strong enough to cope with it. Some wanted to go straight on the electrical wire and commit suicide, even from our group. I don't know, maybe I was younger then and I was stronger. And one day I remember somebody came and asked, who knows how to knit? And I said, yes, I do. And they gave me a set of needles, of course, improvised. They cut my fingers, but I was knitting. They gave me some sort of yarn, and I was knitting gloves for somebody. And whenever there was a countdown, they had to, in the middle of the night, 2 o'clock in the morning, everybody out, and they counted the people. I didn't have to go out because I was the one that was making the gloves. So you see, there were really moments that you never anticipated what will save you, what will help you.
We saw the other women who were even worse than us because they were longer in Auschwitz than we were. I will never forget the experience that's constantly in my mind. When one time, I don't know why, but probably I was sent with another one or two girls to bring the so-called cereal, you know, the cream of or whatever, you know, the porridge or whatever, to which was really water, hot water. And as we were walking with that from the kitchen to our barrack, there were shadows of women appeared because it was like 4 o'clock in the morning, with shaven heads, already dressed in these tattered clothes of Auschwitz, and they put their bowls that they had, which they probably used for other purposes also, into our cereal and grabbed it on the way as we were carrying it. They were so terribly hungry. They had no control of their actions or their emotions or nothing. And we were thinking, my God, are we going to become like that, you know? So that's one of the most terrifying experiences, and the total feeling of hopelessness, because we didn't know, we hoped that Schindler will get us out, but how could we be sure?
Tristo Schindlerovih žena čekalo je i nadalo se u Auschwitzu. A u Krakovu je Schindler ponovno priveden. Istražni tim SS-a uhitio je zapovjednika Amona Goethea zbog sumnje u trgovanje na crnome tržištu, a on je pri tome optužio svog prijatelja Oskara. Prošlo je nekoliko dana dok nisu proradile Schindlerove standardne veze među vojnim obavještajcima i u inspektoratu za naoružanje. Nakon što je ponovno izašao na slobodu, Schindler se posvetio ženama. S jednom prijateljicom iz Češke dogovorio je da otputuje u Auschwitz. Ondje se susrela s jednim višim časnikom, te je s njim provela noć. Ubrzo, nakon toga, Schindlerove su radnice bile spremne za odlazak. No u Auschwitz su stigli novi logoraši. U Brinlicu se dogodila katastrofa. U Schindlerovi su odsutnosti okupili sve dječake, zajedno s očevima, i poslali ih u isti onaj zloglasni logor smrti u kojemu su sada čekale njihove majke.
My son said to me, "Daddy, you know, I'm so sorry that you have to die because I'm a child. So now, while my son noticed in Auschwitz that some movements under the train, you could see ladies' legs, so he got some feeling and he started whistling our signal. So my sister had a signal. She looked through a crack in the wall of the train. It was train for horses. And she noticed my son and her son.
And all of a sudden she started to yell, "Manzi, look, look, Manzi, look, there are our children. There is Richard, there is Oleg. There was another little boy, Eugen, his name was Genek Ginter. And I looked through and I saw my boy. So I wanted to talk to him. I wanted to yell to him or to whistle to him or make myself that he should know that I'm here.
He should start to knock on the doors. So the German said to me, Vasilios, what's happened? He said, "Listen, I see this, my son. Maybe I see my last time in my life. Please let me out." He said, "All right, go down under the train. Make believe you're doing something, you know?"
And I went under this train and I called out, "Oleg, Oleg, Oleg." And I whistled and he saw me and I saw him. And I said, "Olushu, you are hungry?" He said, "No, Mamushu, look, I have potatoes."
That was a pretty incredible coincidence to be at the same place at the moment. And I do recall being with my cousin, I do recall being with my uncle. We have tattoo numbers that follow each other. I even recall an instance with a boy of my age at the time who was screaming so much when he was tattooed that they had to cross out his tattoo because the man who was putting it out made an error.
Za Schindlerove radnice muka završila. Bio je to jedini zabilježeni transport logoraša iz Auschwitza u povijesti rata.
When we arrived in Brinlitz, if I remember correctly, it was very early in the morning and it was cold and it was gray. And of course, when we got out of the cattle trains, completely dirty, and besides this, we were smeared with paint, you know, because they smeared us with paint before we left Auschwitz. So in case somebody intended to escape, would be easily spotted, you know, on the way. So we arrived and we got off the train. And we formed the fives, you know, as usually we did. And I always had the same five women, you know, together. And one of my girlfriends said, "You know, look at the chimneys. We came here and they're going to gas us." And her name was Margot. And I said, "Margot, you know, they could have done it in Auschwitz. We are now coming to Schindler. I'm sure they won't do it." So they marched us to the site of the camp. And the gates were open. And we walked in. And Schindler was standing there in his little Tyrolean hat with a little feather. And he was surrounded by SS officers, guards, and woman guards. And he smiled at us and greeted us and says, look, finally you are with me. And don't worry. Even though the factory wasn't finished yet, I mean, our sleeping quarters, we slept on straw, on the floor, it didn't matter because we were with him and we knew that from that time on, providing something unforeseen would happen, we are safe because if it were in his power and in his... he would take care of us.
Schindler je ispunio obećanje. Zahvaljujući hrani s crnog tržišta i činjenici da je Njemce uvjerio kako je njegova mala tvornica i dalje ključna za ishod rata. Propagandni filmovi prikazivali su velike tvornice poput Krupa i Farbena, koje su bile učinkovite čak i onda kada su Njemci gubili u ratu. No, iako je Schindler plaćao SS-u za rad svojih židova, nije bio Krup ili Farben.
I was assigned to the tool department. I was a tool maker. I had no idea how to make tools. I worked under a man who really was an expert in it and had three helpers, and neither one of the helpers knew what they were doing. None of the tools that we were making tools for big presses, none of the tools that we made were ever working. So the plant was working every day, but nothing ever came out of there. And we always wondered, how did it happen? How did the German authorities allow him to do it? What will happen if somebody comes into the plant and sees what's going on? Then I found out, it was way after the war, that Schindler was buying some of the products on the black market and delivering to the German authorities as product coming out of this factory.
Unatoč Schindlerovim naporima, Njemcima nije išlo dobro. Ruska je vojska sve više napredovala, a oni su sve intenzivnije evakuirali logore smrti u Poljskoj. 24. siječnja 1945. čuvari SS-a iskrcali su pred vrata Schindlerove tvornice vlak zatvorenika iz logora Goleschau, koji se nalazi u blizini Auschwitza.
Ali dva je sagten, da wir haben einen transport von Häftlinge, die aus dem Lager Goleschau kommen. Sagten, wenn sie, wir sind 14 Tage am Weg, die Fabrik, wo sie bestimmt war, nehmen die Menschen nicht an. Wir können nicht mehr weiter. Wir sind halb erfroren. Wenn Sie das nicht übernehmen, lasse ich den Waggon aufmachen und schieße alle zusammen. Und lasse hier. Daraufhin haben wir dann mit dem Ingenieur Schöneborn, der hat meinen Mann angerufen, auch nach Krakau, haben wir dann gesprochen, ne? Und haben gesagt, wir werden den Transport übernehmen.
We worked for hours with picks, shovels. We poured hot water. The carloads were frozen, complete frozen. When we finally opened one up and we ran to grab somebody who we see was in pain. Excuse me for the expression, but I cannot say it any other way than what I saw, is when we lift them up, is the skin of their behind were frozen, was ripped. And they were screaming and yelling. And when we saw the pain, we worked slowly. And we had to watch too much of hot water, then we would burn them. Too little, it didn't help.
Aber ich habe zum ersten Mal in meinem Leben Menschen gesehen, wo ich nicht wusste, ob das Frauen oder Männer sind. Ich konnte nicht erkennen, ob das sind Männer oder ob das sind Frauen. Weil die waren nur Haut und Knochen. Die Augen hatten sie leuchtend und so groß. Hier war alles eine Mumie. Das waren die Menschen, die aus dem Goleschau gekommen sind. Krank, ohne Essen, die sind verhungert, die sind gestorben, die sind erfroren. Das kam in Brünnlitz an.
Preživjeli iz vlaka koji je stigao iz Goleschaua izgledali su poput ovih logoraša snimljenih u Belsenu. Nitko od njih nije težio više od 35 kilograma. Za preminule je Schindler kupio parcelu na mjesnome groblju. Svi su pokopani uz potpune židovske obrede. Preživjeli su hranili i njegovali kako bi se bar donekle oporavili.
Shortly before the end of the war, I remember Schindler's birthday, and we, I think somebody baked even a cake, and we observed the, his birthday on the factory itself, and we sang to him happy birthday, and he had a little speech. He was very good at it, I must tell you this. He pointed out how safe we are in that corner of the world where there is no war, and that we are really protected. And he made us stand at silence in memory of our dead people. You see, this last incident, somebody might tell you that it was a very smart trick on his part, on Schindler's part, that this was strictly propaganda for the future, to save his skin. I don't know what was going through his mind, I won't tell you. Either way, these are the facts, this is what happened. What was his motivation, I don't know.
Morning at 2:41 a.m. at General Eisenhower's headquarters, General Jodl, the representative of the German High Command, and of Grand Admiral Dönitz, the designated head of the German state, signed the act of unconditional surrender of all...
On the last day of the war, it was a moment I never forget in my life. Schindler set up speakers in the plant and announced that we are going to listen to Churchill's victory speech. But there weren't that many people who understood English. However, the atmosphere was sort of electrical. Everybody stood at attention and listened to a speech. They couldn't understand the words, but sort of they could feel the meaning of that speech. I took some English lessons before the war, and here and there I understood some passages of the speech. And it was one of the greatest moments, because at that moment we realized that we are safe, that we are home, that we survived. We did not know that we were so few of us that survived.
Mrtvi i živi mrtvaci. Ljudi koji su preživjeli više od cijelog desetljeća terora. Logori su polako počeli otkrivati sve mračne tajne, pa su na površinu izlazili razmjeri onoga što su Njemci učinili u ime nacionalsocijalizma. I dok su one koji su samo slijedili zapovjedi odvodili u pritvor, židovski zatvorenici u Brindlicu počeli su smišljati kako da svog tamničara Schindlera prebace Amerikancima što dalje od Rusa, jer su bili uvjereni kako će ga oni na mjestu strijeljati.
Dr. Hirschstein, he was one of the prominent of the camp, came to me and asked me to do some very, very important job. I asked him, what is it? You were chosen, Richard, to save the life of Oskar Schindler, to take him from the camp outside and bring him to the Americans. You will do it? So I told him, yes, of course I will do it. We owe him Oskar Schindler this.
Minutu poslije ponoći, 9. svibnja 1945. Njemačkoj vojsci se u bijegu pridružio veoma neobičan konvoj. Schindler sa ženom i ljubavnicom. U sportskom autu za kojim je išao kamion s dvije prikolice pune mladih židova, u ulozi tjelesnih čuvara koji će zaštititi svoga bivšeg tamničara i jamčiti za njega. Čekao ih je težak put.
I was going about 50-60 mile an hour, but after once instantly we jump into a very, very big column of Waffen-SS and Wehrmacht. So I was in really in a jam. And we went into the Böhmerwald, it's the Bohemian forest. And this hilly road, very hilly road, and I use very much the brakes. And after 50, 60 kilometers, I lose my brake in the car. So you can imagine, and with the 30 tons without brake. So I put on the two wings, two friends of mine, I gave them a big piece of wood. When I couldn't start, they stopped anymore the car with the gear. So they jump and put the big pieces of wood under the wheels, because I was in big danger. When I would make an accident with a German military car, probably they will give me a small bullet in my head. So we went about 100 more kilometers. And then we were very surprised, from the forest went out five Russians, Cossacks. And that I can never forget, thousands of Germans with heavy weapon. They ran away like small children, yelling, "Ivan! Ivan kommt!" They ran away. And the second thing I remember, the first was an officer. In pure German he said, "Kameraden," with his hand, "Kameraden, keine Angst, weiterfahren." Also, "Don't be afraid, kamerads, please go ahead." In this moment, I gave my jacket to Oskar Schindler and I told him, "Listen to me, you are no more director for me, you are Oskar." And I gave him we have a special hats, because I was bald-headed, and he is his hair. And so you are from a concentration camp, you should remember it. The third thing, one of the Cossacks came very near to us, and with his knife, he cut the watch of Schindler, was a golden watch, and coated in the air and ran away.
Njemački industrijaliste postoje zatvorenik koncentracijskog logora za Židove. To je bilo dovoljno da njega i njegovu židovsku pratnju prebaci do sigurnosti švicarske granice. Ovdje je nastala ova fotografija. Auschwitz je oslobođen početkom 1945. Kada su stigli Rusi s filmskim ekipama, ovdje su zatekli dječake koje su prošloga studenog dovezli iz Schindlerova Brinlica. Među njima je bio i Richard Horowitz.
I was just about 5 years old when I was liberated in Auschwitz by the Red Army. And I remember quite vividly a group, a small platoon of soldiers who round us up, whatever children were left, and I was one of probably the youngest, in front of a gallows, to use it as a picturesque reference material. And then later on we walked through a narrow path between barbed wires, and there was a group of children and elderly people who happened to, you know, to be there at the time. And then afterwards, not knowing where my family was, there was nobody around at the time. My mother and my sister was in another camp, and my father was made to walk to Mauthausen. And I was taken to an orphanage in Krakow.
Richarda su spojili s majkom nakon što se ona na kraju rata vratila u Krakow iz Brinlica. Da je živ, otkrila je tek nakon što je vidjela ovu snimku na filmskim vijestima. U kolovozu 1946. u Krakovu je počelo suđenje Amonu Getu, koji nije pokazivao nikakvo kajanje. Objesili su ga 13. rujna zbog ratnih zločina. Što se tiče Schindlera, nakon rata nije postigao bog zna što. U Njemačkoj je imao velike planove, ali nije mogao naći posao. Onda je 1949. dobio novčanu nagradu od židovsko-američke dobrotvorne udruge, te odlučio emigrirati u Argentinu sa ženom, aktualnom ljubavnicom i s nekoliko židova koje je spasio. No, ni u Argentini nije bio bolje sreće.
Dat hat es angefangen, dass er nicht mehr der Mann gewesen ist, was er vorher gewesen ist. Er hat nicht mehr die Willenskraft, er hat sie gehen lassen. Er hat nicht mehr den Willen aufgebracht, gegen dieses Schicksal zu kämpfen. Er hat sich schwimmen lassen, er hat nichts mehr angefangen. Das war das Ganze, die Hauptsache. Er hat gelebt, es wird schon etwas kommen. Er hat gelebt, wie die Argentinier manchmal leben. Was geht mich morgen an, heute sind wir da.
Schindler je 1958. napustio ženu i vratio se u Njemačku. Osnovao je cementaru koja je bankrotirala. Onda mu se 1962. osmjeknula sreća. Prvi je put otišao u Izrael. Ondje su ga njegovi Židovi veličanstveno dočekali.
Everybody of us thought that he was the only one to whom he helped with something. And suddenly it came out that everybody has a story about Schindler. The one has a story that his glasses were broken and he was desperate. He can't see anything. It was Schindler who provided him a pair of new glasses. Another woman, she had a hidden child in Poland and he brought her up, he brought her from time to time a message from her child. A third woman he came into the hospital, well, to the place where ill were treated, and he asked her if she needs something, and she wanted just an apple. And he brought her an apple.
Nakon godina provedenih u pustoši, u Izraelu se život Oskara Schindlera pretvorio u jednu veliku proslavu. Njegovi su se posjeti pretvorili u godišnji događaj.
I'm not sure if he wanted the gratitude, but he wanted to be surrounded by people. He liked receptions, big receptions. And here he felt excellent. He wanted to have everybody around. He wanted to tell these stories, prominent people present, to repeat again and again. Well, this was Schindler. This is the man. And we had to accept Schindler as he was. Because if he wouldn't be like he was, nobody else of a normal kind of thinking was ready to do what he has done.
Izrael je slavio Schindlera. 1963. postao je treći čovjek kojemu je dodijeljena titula pravednika među narodima. Njegovo stablo stoji u aveniji pravednika. No, nisu svi preživjeli sigurni u njegove motive.
After all, to me, Schindler was still a German, a Nazi. I never gonna believe he was a Jew lover. To me, he represent German system, Nazi, and he was a guy who made money.
Schindler je 11 mjeseci na godinu živio u siromaštvu u jednosobnom stanu nasuprot željezničke postaje u Frankfurtu. Ugovor o snimanju filma prošao jednako kao što je i došao. Novac je potrošen, a film nikada nije snimljen. Živio je od malene mirovine i milostinje preživjelih. Puno je pio. Onda ga je u jesen 1964. njemačka televizijska ekipa snimila ispred stana i pitala zašto je pomogao Židovima iz Krakova.
Die Verfolgung der jüdischen Menschen im Generalgouvernement im polnischen Raum haben hier in ihren Grausamkeiten eine allmähliche Steigerung genommen. Im Jahre 39 und dann 40 mit den Judenstern und die Einschließung und Zusammenpferchung der Menschen im Ghetto haben natürlich den Sadismus in der Reinkultur erst im Jahre 41 und 42 geoffenbart und dann denkender Mensch, der mit dem inneren Schweinehund siegreich fertig wurde, musste einfach helfen. Es war keine andere Möglichkeit.
Schindler je umro 9. listopada 1974. Napokon su ga izdali srce i jetra.
When I heard from my friends that Oscar died, And I felt very sad, of course, because he was not so old, but he was 66. And I felt very bad, like a brother or my father died. And the people asked me to go to Frankfurt, so I told them I will go because I'm very honored. First of all, I saved him from Brinlitz, and now I am honored to bring him to make the funeral in Israel, to bring him back to his home, because he told us always, my home is in Israel.
Tri tjedna poslije okupili su se u katoličkoj crkvi na brdu Sion u Jeruzalemu da pokopaju Oskara Schindlera. Židovi koji nikada prije nisu ušli u kršćanski vjerski objekt, došli su mu odati počast. I iako nitko nije mogao točno reći tko je bio Oskar Schindler, njegov je trajni doprinos čovječanstvu bio vidljivo urezan na lica ljudi iz Srednje Europe koji su toga dana sjedili u klecalima. Schindler je svojim ljudima dao neprocjenjiv dar.
Thanks to Schindler's efforts, we survived as a family. I still have parents alive today. They are in their 80s. And we realize that we are very few survivors who survive as a family. There are very few who have parents, and all my friends who are survivors are quite envious of us, that my wife and myself have parents, and my children have grandparents.
I was the youngest person, or one of the youngest person who owes his life to, you know, to Schindler's maneuvers. Looking at it in, you know, in perspective and recollecting it as an adult, there's no question that I feel certain homage to, you know, to the man, whoever he was and however he did it. I mean, who cares, you know? Life is really what counts.
Kada se Oskar Schindler pripremao na odlazak iz logora posljednjeg dana rata 1945. Židovi iz Brinlica htjeli su mu darovati nešto. Jedan je zatvorenik ponudio svoje zlatne zube, a drugi ih je pretvorio u prsten u koji su ugravirali drevnu židovsku izreku. Onaj tko spasi jednu dušu, spasio je cijeli svijet.